Thank you so much for that special music. We'll have a couple more coming up this evening. What a blessing to our hearts. We do not have to fear because we know God is near. He said, I will never leave you, never forsake you. Perfect love casts out fear, and that's what the love of God does for us. I'd like to ask Pastor Richard Shellabear if he'll come at this time to lead us in a word of opening prayer. Pastor Mr. Shellabear, the minister at Shoalhaven Baptist Church, Nowra, Australia, about 2.5-3 hours south of Sydney. We had a part in planning of the church many, many years ago, probably some 25 years ago, that he's now pastored for a number of years, been a faithful man of God, has a great influence, testimony there in Australia. This is his second time to America, first time to bring his wife along. And so he'll be with Pastor Panichetti tomorrow in the back to join us. I've invited him to join our group going to Sight and Sound. And so I know they'll enjoy that. But if you lead us in opening prayer, so glad to have you here.
Thank you, Pastor. Let's bow and pray. Heavenly Father, we are indeed a grateful people. Lord, as we look about us, we see there is so much that you have done for us, so much to lift up our hearts and help us to rejoice in you. Lord God, tonight as we come together, we pray that you would lift up our hearts here. Lord, this is a great church, a wonderful church, a great people. And Lord God, we pray that you would help us tonight to hear the words that you would have for us.
Yes.
Lord, that you might be a blessing unto us. Lord, that we might glorify you. And we'll thank you for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you're visiting for the first time with us, we want to welcome you. If you would raise your hand for just a moment, that we might pass one of the welcome booklets to you. You can take the card, fill that out, drop that into the offering plate. Also good to have Brother Alan Snare with us. He's with Silent Word Ministries. Brother Snare, welcome. He is always on the road ministering in churches across our country, helping build deaf ministries. And so it's a joy we can have a part in his life and ministry as well.
We will glorify the Lamb. We will glorify. Amen. Thank you, choir, for that this evening. Would you stand as we continue to sing page 305, praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. We'll sing it out together on the first and the last, 305. Praise him. Someone this evening. Together, this great hymn, You Are the Christ, Son of the Living God. There's four verses, sing it out. In the beginning. great singing this evening. Please be seated.
Just want to be able to share with those from the second service what happened in the first service. We had two girls join, Genesis and Janelle, and then Jaylene was dedicated today. That's the first dedication I've had. We had speaking tongues going on at the same time. So she's a toddler, but mom and the two girls were both saved a week ago Tuesday. Dad was saved 4 months ago. And so God is just working in their family. And so when they joined last week, they saw a baby dedication. They said, can we do that? I said, yes, yes. And I said, now typically toddlers don't always come to me first time I meet them, but having the charismatic grandfather personality that I have, she came right to me. For those in second service, she talked and talked and talked all the way through. She's not pictured here, but what a blessing. Now all four of them will be getting baptized on Sunday, next Sunday. And so we rejoice in that and praise God for his spirit moving and continuing to add to our church family. They will be baptized. Now for those who came in right before six, you were sprinkled. That doesn't count. Getting sprinkled by rain doesn't count as baptism, so we'll do it the biblical way, and believer's baptism is after salvation, down in the water, up again, the picture of the death, burial, and resurrection. Also, the picture of my old life is dead, I have a new life in Christ, and that is what the Pichardo family wants and what all of us desire as well. What's happening this week? Well, first of all, I'd like to invite the host families to join me for a very short meeting in the chapel right after the service. And so thank you. Many more signed up to be host families than we actually need. We have just about 20 pastors and wives coming from the various countries. This is not the original Chinese pastors conference that was planned. It has come down now to a different format, but we will have training time Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and then again Saturday morning. Also taking them to Sight and Sound on Saturday, Friday. So lots happening through the week. And so please, please come up to them. They do speak English. And so you can ask them their name, what country they're from, and just to be able to greet them warmly as you always do. But for many, this is their first time to America. And so this is very special to them. And we have sought to be able to do things without having a lot of weight. So you cannot give a lot of heavy gifts for them to take back because of their suitcases. So we've got a nice a Washington, D.C. memento. Is it a paperweight type? And it has all the monuments there. It's very lightweight, but we purchased that for them. On Friday, as we saw Ford's Theater, across the street, catty corner, is the FBI, which you've heard has been in the news lately. Little did we know what was going on, but we have that for them. We're going to do a nice picture and then a certificate that they can have, and then we're going to offer some books to the men, but again, they're very limited on weight. So if you are planning on loading them up with items to take back, just be aware they can't do that. They can't take food items. We will give them tasty cakes to go to Washington on Monday, but other than that, we can't load them up with heavy items because of their luggage. We are going to take them to Philadelphia Saturday afternoon, and then on Monday, Don Schlickman is going to drive them down to Washington, and then Ray and Doris Chang are going to be hosts around the Washington Mall. That is not a shopping center. It is the grassy area between the Capitol Building and Washington Monument, and then get them to a hotel. So they're with us. They arrive Tuesday night, and they leave on Monday morning. And so host families, if you will join me, just a few instructions there about transportation to be able to help out. You don't need to use chopsticks for their Cheerios in the morning, but we wanted to be able to give them a taste of America, but not too much of a taste of America. Though having been there, having had rice, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, I thought cheese steaks morning, noon, and night would be a good thing to be able to let them really experience Americana as it is. So I believe the decision was we're overruling Pastor Joyner and going to Chinatown instead of Pat's and Gino's. So I think they might enjoy that a little bit more. All right, so if you would, plan on being out Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. Let's be gracious, hosts and hostesses. And Thursday night's not normally on your schedule. you want to be out for them. You want to be out for them. I believe they're going to be singing Wednesday night. Pastor Sam is preaching. But Thursday night, we'll see if we can get some more of them to be able to sing. And so put that on your calendar. And along with that, we want to be able to provide child care. And so if you would be able to take a nursery time on Thursday night, just take your connection card and give us your name, contact information, that you could do nursery on Thursday night. That would be greatly appreciated. And I believe, are you scheduled to be singing on Thursday night as well? Do you recall?
We're scheduled, but I think we had the dodgeball.
That's right, Thursday night. So the Herbster team will be at the dodgeball. By the way, that is 5 p.m. that begins. And if we all would pray about that, if you have teenagers or you have contact with teenagers, dodgeball outreach is a lot of fun for the teenagers, but the Herbster will be sharing the gospel with them on Thursday night, and that is at 5 o'clock for that. But if you can do nursery, go ahead and just put your name on there and drop that into the offering here in just a moment. By Saturday, we have the Homeschool Academy of Arts. Let's see, they're going to have a Friday night play at 7 o'clock for elementary. Saturday is a 3 o'clock play on Esther. It's a different Esther than we did last year, but just so you know about the homeschool presentations, Friday, 7 o'clock, Saturday, high school, 3 o'clock, and that is at the Trinity Lighthouse Church down in Royersford, right along the expressway. And so if you want to support them or see them, be sure to put that in your schedule. We have all the meals scheduled for the Asian pastors, I think, except two slots are open. So if you'd like to be able to prepare a meal, you bring it and then have dinner with the Asian pastors. You'll have two pastors and then two couples from VFPT will provide the meal. So if you want to do that, still have time to sign up for that. And many of you signed up to buy tickets to send them to Sight and Sound. Thank you for doing that. There are a few slots open for that. I believe about 17 slots open out of the 45 or so where we've invited the Herbsters. We've also invited the Shellabears to come. And most of the pastors have already been, so we're just going to Shady Maples so they don't get lost. And then we'll send them on to the Tabernacle Tour in Lancaster, and a mile away is Sight and Sound. And so they'll be going for that. And so that's it for the week. And then all of our staff, Brother Farrell's coming in, Brother Herbster, all be having sessions. We have a teaching booklet for them, and a couple of lady sessions that are going to be having as well for them. So all ministry training, and so it's we're honored, we're humbled that we could be a part of their lives. And so you pray for them, come out and meet them Wednesday at 7. Thursday at 7, singles, teen, deaf ministry, all be in here Wednesday night, Thursday night. Wednesday night, we will have the Master Club. So the Master Club will continue on as normal on Wednesday night. At this time, we'll have our ushers come. We'll receive our tithes and offerings tonight. At the end of the service, we'd like to take a second offering, a love offering for the Herbster Evangelistic Team. And typically, we would have a week of meetings, and we'd have opportunity Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. We don't have that opportunity. That opportunity is now. So right at the end of the service, after the invitation, the ushers will come back and we'll have a second offering, and that'll be a love offering for Herbsters, and they'll have some special music during that time as well. And so God has given us great opportunities for all of these things. Also, Veterans Appreciation Services, it is coming up in just 2 weeks with Cleve McCleary. Be sure to take an invitation and just begin to ask. Begin to ask folks if, and you can see sometimes, it might be a hat, it might be a pin, it might be something that you'll see at work that might identify them as a veteran. I have to say, our young people were just amazing as the Lincoln Memorial, Vietnam Memorial, World War II Memorial, a lot of veterans were brought in from different places. And our teenagers would go right up, introduce themselves, thank you for serving our country. Some said, can we get our picture with you? One of the pictures was three different wars represented by the veterans, World War II, Korean, and Vietnam, to have these three veterans in front of the Vietnam Memorial and have our teenagers come around, just a few of them there that were at that location, take a picture. We'll have to show that to you. But what a blessing to see the patriotism, love for God and country among our young people. Patriotism must be taught. It must be taught. And when you see the thousands of names there at the Vietnam Wall, when you see the World War II memorial and understand of the hundreds of thousands of men and women died fighting for freedom against Adolf Hitler from many countries. And so we honor their sacrifice by standing attention to our flag when we sing the national anthem. Amen. We put our hand over our heart. Do we have leaders that are corrupt? Do we have police officers that don't always follow the law? Well, sure we do. But we show honor to God and country when that anthem is sung. And so patriotism must be taught. And I'm glad our kids and our teens, they're catching it. They understand far beyond many of our politicians, many beyond those in the media. Our kids get it. Our teens get it. When those without reason say the most foolish things, oh, they're just expressing their freedom. They don't understand what freedom is. They don't. But our young people do. And so we can thank God. We can do these things and be able to show honor to whom honor is due. I'd like to ask Brother Zedzi if he'd ask a blessing upon our offering. We are thrilled to have back the Herbster team and Brother Herbster to the pulpit to preach the word of God tonight. Your blessing to us today. Look forward to God's word through you tonight.
Dear God, we do thank you that we can come to you in freedom and worship you. And as Brother Herbster preached this morning, that our worship is just not on Sunday when we meet as a body of corporate believers, but that we can be each day throughout the week. May that be our heart's desire to serve you sacrificially in our lifestyle, in our witness, in all that we do. We pray and ask for the Asian pastors who will be coming over on Tuesday night. I pray, Lord, for their safety as they come over from several different countries. They'll be flying over in long flights. I pray that everything would go smoothly, that they would get here. I pray that our church would be a blessing to them, an encouragement to them, to lift them up, Lord, and help them get the teaching that they need while they're here, and also to see some of the sights that we have in our country. And Lord, I just pray that our church could be a blessing to them. As Pastor mentioned, there are many activities going on this week. Lord, they're all possible because of our offering, of our tithes and offerings that we give to you. We thank you so much for how you've blessed our church, and may our giving just be another part of worshiping you. In Jesus' name, amen.
When morning mist appears at dawn, and sun rays break through early haze, may love for you and day's done, and I lie down. my soul to keep. I love you, Lord, with all my heart. I love you, Lord, with all my soul. I love you, Lord, with all my might. Increase my love and keep it whole. Increase my love.
Well, this is the great command, that we would love the Lord God with all of our heart and our neighbor as ourself, in a hope that God would well up within you a greater love for him. As a result of being here in God's house today and hearing God's word, as a result of singing the praises of God here today, that you would love God in a greater way. Well, I'm looking forward to this week. I'm thankful for the opportunities with the young people, thankful for the opportunities with these Asian pastors. I have been so blessed to have the privilege of traveling across the world and visiting some of the countries where these men and ladies will be from. And I do believe that you are having a great impact. And this is a wonderful blessing to be able to minister to pastors and Christian leaders from across the world. I don't know if you're aware of this, but many thousands of people are coming to the Savior in Asia. And so it's a privilege for us to encourage and push on and strengthen these great Christian leaders and servants of God. And I hope that you will just roll out the red carpet, as I know you always do here at Valley Forge Baptist Temple. And hope you'll, as Pastor mentioned, just get to know some of these folks. I'm looking forward to meeting them. These folks are heroes of the faith. They are tremendous servants of the Lord. And they are sacrificing in such great ways that we probably will never even fully understand. And it is a privilege for us to be around them and meet them and encourage them this week. So I hope you'll plan to be back on Wednesday. I'm looking forward to each of those services, Wednesday and Thursday. And of course, my good friend, Brother Tom Farrell, you know well. And he is a mentor to me, one of my heroes in ministry. He'll be here on Thursday night. And of course, you won't want to miss that service on Thursday night as well. It's just been a wonderful day already, and I'm thankful for the privilege again tonight to share the Word of God with you. I appreciate so much this church and so many faithful people, so many faithful servants of the Lord on staff here, and I trust that tonight the message will be an encouragement to all of you to continue to be faithful all the way to the end. Take your Bibles and turn to 2 Timothy chapter 3, 2 Timothy chapter 3. The book of 2 Timothy is a powerful book in the New Testament which reminds us of this simple theme that I've already brought to your attention tonight, and that is that God wants us to be faithful. You know, as you look across churches today and you look across even Christian ministry today, often it is hard to find people who are the same today as they were 5 years ago, who are just consistent, steady, reliable, faithful. You know, it's really wonderful when you can go to a church and be in a congregation where you can look across the auditorium and think to yourself, wow, I'm so thankful that person, they are sure faithful. That family over there, let me tell you about them. They are really consistent, and boy, they've been here for so many years. Isn't it wonderful to have a lot of faithful people? But sad to say, there's also a lot of unfaithful people. And God is looking for us to be faithful people. You know, you may not be fruitful, but you can be faithful. You see, the issue is not how much fruit. The issue is not how much success. The issue is not how you excel and people acknowledge you. The issue is faithfulness. Moreover, it is required in a steward that a man be found faithful. So the goal is not necessarily to be fruitful, though we should be, and we, if we're true believers, we will be fruitful. But we don't gauge our faithfulness based on the fruit that we see. I also want to say tonight that it's important for us to remember that sometimes you don't feel good about your service to the Lord. Sometimes you don't have a good feeling of faithfulness. You don't have a good feeling of emotion when you're ministering or you're faithful at your church. But you know what? We should not live our lives based on feelings. Haven't you realized this? Your feelings are like a roller coaster. And there are days where you may not feel like being faithful. So the issue is not your feeling, the issue is not your fruit, the issue is being faithful. And I think that the Apostle Paul draws us into that theme in this final letter that he wrote in the New Testament. And he writes it to his young friend in the faith, his name is Timothy. And he instructs us, under inspiration, he instructs us, as well as Timothy, be faithful. Steady, reliable, consistent Christians. That's what God is looking for. And so I just want to encourage you and exhort you that first of all, you need to be faithful to God, but you also need to be faithful to God's church. And you also need to be faithful to the other commitments that God has called you to commit yourself to. And sad to say, across America today, people are really faithful to one thing, themselves. And it's really important that we get our eyes off of ourselves and we realize that the faithfulness that we are talking about are commitments that are way greater, a whole lot bigger than ourselves. And I think the Apostle Paul was a good person to write this text to remind us to be faithful because would you agree that he was faithful? Paul was faithful. It's in this book that he says, I have fought a good fight. I mean, think about this. He's at the end of his life. He's about ready to die. He's going to be a martyr. Historians tell us shortly after he wrote the book, he is martyred for the cause of Christ. So he says, with confidence, he says, I have fought a good fight. Wouldn't it be great to say that at the end of your life? I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there are laid up for me crowns of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but all them that love his appearing. Wow, I think Paul was acknowledging that he had done the best he could, but we should surely say that as soon as Paul saw Jesus, he probably still wished he had done more. And we will too. No matter what you do, no matter how zealous and fervent you are, you will still wish you had done more for God when you see your Savior face to face. So the Apostle Paul has good reason to instruct Timothy because Timothy was his disciple. Timothy was his son in the faith. He was shy, he was sickly, and he could have had the tendency to quit on God and quit on the lessons that he had learned from Paul. And so Paul instructs him specifically in chapter 3. He instructs him to be faithful to Jesus Christ, to be faithful as a pastor, preacher, Christian. And I want to instruct you and encourage you to be faithful. To be steady and reliable Christians. He says this in chapter 3, starting in verse 10. He says, but thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience. You see the Apostle Paul laying his whole life out in front of this young man. Timothy had the privilege of seeing everything about Paul. I mean, look at all those things that are listed. He was holding nothing back, and I do think this is an appropriate way to view discipleship. It's showing our life and living our life in front of someone that we are training and teaching and instructing and letting them just view the truth, letting them view the truth being lived out in your life. That's real discipleship, as Paul even told us earlier in the book, that we should commit to others the things that we have learned. And so Paul starts into this discussion to Timothy, and he's leaving his final plea to Timothy in this final letter, and he's reminding Timothy that I've shown you what it's like to be faithful, and you can be faithful. And I think that Paul goes into this discussion by revealing four simple realities that you need to remember if you're going to be faithful. You see, faithfulness doesn't just happen. Faithfulness cannot just be placed upon you. Faithfulness is a choice that you make, and I would say primarily the choice starts in your thinking. It starts in your mind. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. And so there are some realities, some truths of Scripture that we need to remember if we're going to be faithful. Paul gives four of them in this text, and I'd like to give those to you tonight to encourage you, to strengthen you in your resolve to just be faithful. Maybe you're a little discouraged. Maybe you feel like quitting. Maybe you're just about ready to stop being faithful. I just want to encourage you, it's worth it. Be faithful to God. You can continue in those things which you have learned. And so Paul draws us into this first reality, this first truth, starting in verse 11, when he goes on by saying, Timothy, you have seen my persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured. But out of them all the Lord delivered me. Here's the first reality, verse 12, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Now, I know that this is not the good news that you were expecting to hear, but here is the reality of faithfulness. If you are going to be faithful, you need to remember you will be persecuted. You need to remember persecution is promised. Reality number one, persecution is promised. And I think Paul had every reason to talk about this, don't you? Here he is in Rome, the second time in prison, in a dungeon in Rome. Timothy was fully aware of the persecutions as they're listed for us in verse 11. He even mentions three cities. These cities, at these specific times in Paul's life, were intense persecutions that he faced. The city of Iconium, or excuse me, the city of Antioch, the first city mentioned. In Acts chapter 13, verse 50, Paul and Barnabas have to leave the city of Antioch because of a plot against them. They are persecuted and expelled and kicked out of the city. Persecution in Antioch. How about Iconium? Acts chapter 14, verses 5 and 6, where the Bible tells us that Paul had to leave the city of Iconium because of a plot to stone him to death. Everywhere he went, he was being persecuted. And then he mentions this town of Lystra. The town of Lystra was actually Timothy's home, Timothy's hometown in which Paul met him. And when Paul passed through his town, he also had persecutions, and probably Timothy experienced these persecutions along with Paul. And in Lystra, in Acts chapter 14, the Bible tells us that Paul was actually stoned. This time the plot actually came to fruition. The plot actually happened, and they actually stoned Paul, and he was miraculously saved. He did not die. God was with him, and God was able to save him. But surely you know that everywhere Paul went, he faced persecution. And so he has every reason to say to young Timothy, you will suffer, because anyone who does anything great for God, any faithful servant of God, is going to suffer. Persecution is promised. Now, surely you've recognized in American society, it is not getting easier to be a born-again believer. We are mocked, we are ridiculed, we are laughed at, we are persecuted, and yet the persecutions we face in America pale in comparison to the persecutions that are happening around the world. Where literally today, this week, as we are living in the freedom of America, there are people who wake up every day wondering if that is the day that their life is going to be taken, whether that is the day that the Muslims or some other group are going to come and knock on their door and say, deny salvation in Christ, deny Christianity, or you are going to die. Convert to Islam, convert to some false religion, or you are going to die. Folks, that is literally happening in the world today, where people are having to stand up for Christ even when they lose their lives, even knowing they're going to die. All that live godly shall suffer persecution. You know, the Apostle Paul lists out his persecutions in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. We don't have time to look at this text, but it's amazing. When you see all the things that Paul went through, all the suffering that he went through, all the things from without the church and all the things from within the church, the suffering that he went through. We look at Paul and we say, we would love to be like the apostle. We would love to be greatly used like Paul, but remember, Paul suffered. Paul had all kinds of problems. So why do we want a life of ease? Why do we want everything handed to us on a silver platter? Why do we think that if you're going to serve God, you're never going to have any issues? Listen, Jesus himself suffered. Jesus was the most persecuted person ever. He was crucified. So I ask you, are we any greater than our master? We are not. We are going to suffer. And I am afraid that no matter who the president might be in just a little while, that the suffering in America may continue to rise for true Christians that are following the truth of the Bible. And we better be ready for it. Don't back up. Don't slack up. Be faithful to God, even though you're going to be persecuted. Persecution is promised. Jesus himself said this in Matthew 5, verse 11. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. Paul said this in 2 Corinthians 12:10. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. So this is the testimony of the Scripture. We cannot forget this simple truth. Persecution is promised. If you forget this, then you will quit, you'll get discouraged, and you'll think to yourself, well, if that's going to happen to me, it's not worth it to serve God. And I'm going to tell you that anybody that serves God in a great way is going to suffer. So just remember this. The truth is, persecution is promised. And so in this book of 2 Timothy, you see this theme. Notice chapter 2, verse 3, where he encourages Timothy about this issue of persecution. Remember, Timothy was shy, he was sickly, he could have given in. And he tells him in chapter 2, verse 3, thou therefore, here's the word, endure hardness. He's assuming that the hardness is going to come, and it will. It will for all those that live godly in Christ. He says in chapter 2, verse 12, you see the theme again. If we suffer, he's assuming, we could literally say it this way, since we suffer, we will also reign with him. You're going to suffer, but that's the joy of a believer, to suffer for the cause of Christ. He says this in chapter 4, verse 5, but watch thou in all things endure afflictions. This is a theme throughout the book of 2 Timothy because he's warning Timothy, be faithful and don't forget, you're going to suffer. Persecution is promised. Go back to chapter 3, and I want you to notice as we continue through this text that as Paul is encouraging us under inspiration to be faithful, there is something else he brings to our attention. So we see that persecution is promised, but moving into verse 13, we find another significant reality of life, reality of ministry, reality of that we need to remember if we're going to be faithful. Here's what it says in verse 13, 2 Timothy 3, verse 13. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Simple verse that reminds us, number two reality, and that is perverseness is predicted. Why are we so surprised when everything's getting worse when it actually tells us it's going to get worse? I mean, look back at chapter 3, verse 1, and how Paul predicts and prophesies under inspiration the last days, which are those days that Jesus could come. I believe Paul thought he was living in the last days. I think he definitely thought Timothy was going to be living in the last days. And the last days refer to any time Jesus could come because his return is imminent. He could come at any moment. Wouldn't it be great if he came before this service is out? So we are, as they were, living in the last days. Doesn't it frustrate you when people start to put up a timeline for the coming of the Lord? And all these certain events have to happen and all these different things have to be seen. Listen, there is no sign for the second coming because if it's imminent, that means in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, Jesus could come. And so the last days refer to any time that Jesus could come, and that would be now. That would be now. And so he in some ways is predicting the time period of their day, but I think he's also just predicting the way it is. This is the way it is across all of the last days. Verse 1 says this, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come, dangerous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. You would think that he was describing American culture. But hold on, folks, not only American culture, but sadly, Christian culture. Aren't you aware that we are not just fighting against contemporary culture, but we're actually fighting against contemporary Christianity too? Because haven't you noticed that Christianity is just a few steps behind the culture? And he says, from such turn away. This is the description of the world. This is the description of the heathen culture. This is the description of how bad it could get and continue to get. And then he tells us in verse 13, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse. You know, I do not think it's appropriate for us as Christians to live with a pessimistic doomsday attitude. There is hope. The hope is not in who the president is or the better government that we might have. The hope is in the gospel. The gospel of Jesus Christ. I don't think it's appropriate for us to live with this attitude, oh no, everything's bad, it's never going to get better, we'll never see revival. I don't think that we should live with that kind of attitude. I think we should understand that faithful Christians can make a difference in the culture and the climate of our day. So we know that he's talking about the culture at large, but we also know he's talking about Christianity, because in verse 13 he mentions these two groups of people, evil men and seducers. This is a direct statement about false teaching, false teachers. Are you aware that some of the largest churches in American society are being pastored and taught by people who are not even genuine believers? So do not be surprised by this. It's going to keep getting worse and worse. All you got to do is every once in a while turn on Christian television and you'll see it's getting worse and worse. It's pretty frustrating, isn't it, to hear the kind of heresy, false teaching, false doctrine that is propagated in the name of Christianity. And it's going to wax worse and worse. And this is important for us to recognize, because as the world is getting worse, we as Christians should be growing in grace. We should be pressing on the upward way, new heights gaining every day, not gradually becoming more worldly and progressively going the opposite direction, but rather we should be becoming more godly, more holy, more righteous for the Lord. And so this is important for us to recognize, to not follow the trends, not follow all the fads, but to be steady and reliable and consistent. And the philosophy and teaching of the Bible needs to be taught in our lives and practiced throughout our lives, and let's not compromise God's truth by following false teaching, evil men, and seducers. It's important that we are faithful, that we're steady, we're consistent, we are reliable. And if we're going to be that way, we need to remember what Paul told Timothy. Perverseness is predicted. And so he warns Timothy about this by actually mentioning a person's name who got sucked in by all of the worldliness, who got caught up in the culture. You know what this guy's name is? Chapter 4, verse 10, his name is Demas. For Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world. He warns Timothy about getting entangled in chapter 2, verse 4. No man that warreth entangles himself with the affairs of this life. And so we need to be aggressive and fervent, faithful Christians who recognize the world is getting worse, but we should still be growing. We should be stable and set apart and holy unto the Lord. You'll never be faithful unless you recognize the world is not our home. We're just passing through. So let's lay up our treasures somewhere beyond the blue. Let's live for eternity, not for the here and now. This is the truth that Paul is revealing. First of all, persecution is promised. Secondly, perverseness is predicted. And then he goes into verse 14, which is a fantastic statement of hope for us. He says this, but continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. What an amazing statement. Number three, if you're going to be faithful, remember, perseverance is possible. Do not have this attitude, well, it's too hard, it's too corrupt, there's no hope for me. No, perseverance is possible. For every person under the sound of my voice, for every person that names the name of Christ, you can be faithful to God, and you should be. And may I say, you must be, for the cause of Christ, for the glory of God, and for the gospel in this world. God wants you to be faithful, and you can persevere. He uses the word continue. But continue, it's the word remain. It's the same Greek word used to describe when Jesus describes us abiding in him, like the branch abides in the vine. And so we abide in him and we remain with him. This is the word to remain with, to stick with, to let it be a part of your life, to stay by the stuff, to be consistent to the truth that you've been taught. It's interesting that in verse 14, he gives us two ways that you can persevere. First of all, you persevere by being confident that what you believe is actually true. Look what he says. Continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of. This speaks of our confidence. This speaks of understanding our faith in such a way that we are willing to stand on it and be firm on it and be courageous and bold because we know it's true. You see, it's easy to desert things that you are doubting. Doubting Christians are drifting Christians. And maybe you're unsure of some of the doctrine or unsure of the theology or unsure about God and his grace. And maybe you've professed it, but you have really no deep knowledge and understanding of God and his grace. This is why it's so important, as the New Testament tells us in Ephesians chapter 6, that our feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel. Often we use that to describe our witnessing, but actually that's telling us the more you know the gospel, the more prepared you are for the battle. The more you understand the riches of God's grace, the more prepared you are to be stable and secure in the battle. And so we need to be confident in what we believe. You know, apologetics are a good thing. Understanding the evidence, understanding the history, understanding the spiritual truth that we read in the Bible, and being able to defend it and declare it with boldness. This is important because it helps us persevere. When we persevere with confidence in what we have learned. But then he says this, secondly, not only do you persevere when you are confident that what you believe is true, but secondly, you persevere when you think about the people who actually taught you. This is a wonderful blessing, isn't it? To start thinking about throughout our lives, maybe starting with when we were little kids and our parents possibly. Some of you had wonderful homes that taught you the scriptures, like Timothy did, that from a child, the scripture says, verse 15, from a child he understood the holy scriptures. So when we reflect back upon our childhood and we think about our parents maybe teaching us, or maybe you had Sunday school teachers or youth workers and Christian school teachers, you start thinking about different people who exemplified Christ to you, you start remembering them, and then of course you have Bible teachers and pastors and preachers who have helped you and instruct you in the ways of God. When you start thinking about these people and their faithfulness to the truth, it helps you to say, you know what, if they can be steady and reliable, I can be too. And so it's important for us to remember the people who have taught us. Remembering those who have taught us the truth of the Word of God. Now, Paul is specifically referring to his upbringing here because he had a godly mother named Lois and a grandmother named Eunice, but he's also referring to himself. I mean, how terrible it would be for Paul to take him on all of his missionary journeys, take him all across the known world, and then as soon as Paul dies and goes to heaven, Timothy is unfaithful to the truth. And so Paul was a little nervous about this. He's saying to him, you can persevere if you're confident in what you believe and you remember me. Remember what I've taught you. Perseverance is possible. And so he tells Timothy about this throughout the book of 2 Timothy, encourages him to be faithful and persevere all the way to the end. 2 Timothy 2, verse 1, thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. This is a personal, powerful statement that Paul makes throughout the book to say to Timothy, don't quit. You can be faithful. Continue in the things which you have learned. Go back to chapter 3 and let's notice the last reality, because this is really probably the most important reality we need to remember. Persecution is promised. Perverseness is predicted. Perseverance is possible. But don't ever forget what he tells us starting in verse 16, the power which is profitable, the power which is profitable, and that is, of course, the Word of God. This is the classic text of Scripture on the inspiration of the Bible, that God breathed the word that we are reading here this evening. This is God's inspired word, and he says all Scripture is given by inspiration. It's God-breathed. And it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. And so, yes, we will be persecuted. And yes, the world's going to get worse. And yes, there is a potential and possibility for us to persevere through all that wickedness. But we will never have the power to do that without the wonderful Word of God. I think this is intentional in this text, that he is saying all of this truth and then really giving the foundation for the truth, which is the power and the profitability of the Bible. And I want to encourage you to make much of the Word of God in your life, because you will never be faithful without the Bible. You'll never be faithful without loving God's Word, memorizing God's Word, reading God's Word, knowing what God says in His Word. He says it's profitable for doctrine. That means it shows us what's right. For reproof, God's Word shows us what's wrong. For correction, it shows us how to get what's wrong right. For instruction in righteousness, how to keep what's wrong that we got right, how to keep it right. So it shows us what's wrong, it shows us what's right, it shows us how to get it right and how to keep it right. I think God's Word is pretty important for our lives. And then he says that you might be perfect. This is the idea of spiritually mature. Does not mean that there's ever a point in any Christian's life that we have sinless perfection, that we will never do wrong. We need God's help and God's grace. We'll all continue to struggle until the day when there is no more sin, when we go to heaven someday. The idea of this word perfect, that the man of God may be perfect, this is the word complete, mature, a mature believer. There's no way to be mature without the Bible. This is God's truth. Furnished unto all good works. And I do believe that it is the Bible that enables us to be mature in Christ, and that our life will bear much fruit when we are allowing the Word of God to fill us up and we are obeying the Word of God in all of our life. So this is for his personal life, but notice in chapter 4, he talks about his public ministry. And remember something, that the chapter divisions were added. So I think the continuing flow of thought is clear here. He's just told us about the power of the Bible, and he says in chapter 4, verse 1, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. So he's saying to Timothy, Timothy, in your personal life and in your preaching ministry, you better make sure you make much of the Bible, because that's where the power is. Folks, I'm concerned that even in the ministry today, that we are in such an entertainment society that many Christians treat the preaching ministry like it's an entertainment venue. I want you to understand tonight that when somebody is faithfully preaching the Bible, it's the power of the Word that impacts people's lives. Do you realize that some of the greatest preachers throughout church history were not flamboyant in their presentation? As a matter of fact, many of them actually would speak with almost a monotone type voice, but their messages were full of so much doctrine and so much scripture that they were powerfully impacting people's lives. So the power is not in the personality. The power is not in the person or the preacher. The power is in the actual message that is being taught from the Bible. The power is in God's Word. And we need to remember this. We need to be reminded tonight to be faithful by putting God's Word into our life. So I ask you, are you reading the Bible? I mean, can you believe we even have to ask that amongst Christians? Are you reading the Bible? Are you studying the Bible? As Paul tells Timothy, study to show yourself approved unto God. I will tell you, you are not talented enough to be faithful. You are not trained enough to be faithful. You need God's word. Timothy had all the talent. He had all the training. But in order to be faithful, he had to depend upon the word of God. Psalm 119 verse 9 says, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to thy word. With my whole heart have I sought thee. O, let me not wander from thy commandments. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against God. I love Jeremiah 15, 16, where the Bible says, thy word was found, and I did eat it. And it became unto me the joy and rejoicing of my soul. And of course, Hebrews 4:12, where the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing, dividing asunder of soul and spirit, of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Oh, how love I thy law, David said. It is my meditation all the day. This is where the stability comes. This is where consistency arises. It's when we base our life on solid truth. Truth that is supernaturally revealed. We hold it in our hands, the wonderful Word of God. And I want to encourage you tonight that it's impossible to be faithful to God in a day of religious apostasy, in a day of religious apathy, which we all recognize, right? It's impossible to be faithful without depending on God's Word. So you better make much of God's Word in your life. You'll never make it through the persecution. You'll never persevere through the culture. You'll never understand the corruption that you see around you unless you know God's word. And so Paul is encouraging Timothy, as I'm encouraging you, be faithful. Remember these realities. Think about them regularly so that you can be consistent and steady and reliable, so that you don't compromise and change your values, your convictions, your philosophy, the truth of the Bible. And how sad it is to watch individuals and families and even entire ministries who we could say this about. They used to be serving God. They used to believe this. And how quickly people are pulled away into unfaithfulness. I just want to encourage you tonight, be faithful. You need to be faithful to God. You need to be faithful to this church. This is where God has placed you. This is where God is teaching and instructing you. You need to be faithful in your commitments in your family. You need to be faithful to your commitments at work. These are all biblical truths. Obedience to these truths is obedience to the Bible. And so it's important that we are faithful in all these areas, but the most important thing is that we stand before God someday, and he looks at us and he says, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And folks, isn't that what it's all about? That's all that matters. Not our recognition, not our popularity, not our material possessions. You know what matters? Faithfulness. Faithfulness. That's what matters. And if we're going to be faithful, we need to remember these truths. Persecution is promised. Perverseness is predicted. Perseverance is possible. And the power of God's word is very profitable for your life. We can be faithful to God in this day. And I hope that you will be found faithful. The Marine Corps has this slogan, Semper Fi. Always faithful. Isn't that the way every Christian should be? Always faithful. By God's grace, with his power, we can be that way. Consistent, steady, and reliable. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Father, I pray that you would convict us where we have become apathetic and complacent and maybe even unfaithful. Lord, the greatest relationship in the world is our relationship with you. And I pray that we would be committed in that relationship, that we would realize that as we commit ourselves to you, we will suffer as all servants of God have suffered. The world is going to continue to be aggressively against us. False teachers are going to reign, and it's going to look like wickedness is prevailing. But we just need to be faithful. We cannot desert the truth. We cannot desert you as our God. Lord, I pray that we would continue in those things which we have learned, knowing they're the truth, being confident in that truth, and Lord, help us to remember. We cannot forsake the Word of God. God's Word is the power. Your Word is the power for our lives. Lord, I pray that you would convict us tonight where we have become unfaithful. Would you please challenge us and convict us to make a confession, a commitment to you that will help us to be more faithful to a God who is always faithful to us. Do your work in our hearts, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together with our heads bowed and eyes closed. And here's what we're going to do tonight. I'm not even going to ask you to leave your seat to come to the front. But if you need to make a decision and you would like to make a decision, you know God had you here to hear this message tonight. You know you're struggling with whether it's worth it to serve God. I'm about ready to quit. I'm given into sin. I'm not in the Word of God. You know God is speaking to you about something very specific. While we have our heads bowed and eyes closed and the piano will play in just a moment, why don't you just sit down in your chair and talk to the Lord? You don't even have to come to the front. Just sit down in your chair and spend some time in prayer. Right now, as our pianist begins. Just make a decision for the Lord, a specific decision about faithfulness. God is speaking to you about a specific decision. Just sit down in your chair and spend some time quietly talking to the Lord. Song, let's just sing that as a prayer to the Lord. Just the first verse. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my hand and let them move the deep impulse of my love. Thank you for speaking to our hearts tonight. I pray that we would leave this place understanding that this is what counts. This is what matters. It's our faithfulness to you. Help us to be steady, reliable, consistent Christians. And I pray that you would do that not so people recognize us, but God, your name needs to be glorified in this world. I pray that you would use our lives as we go out into this community, as we touch people's lives and they experience the faithfulness that we are trying to live just for the sake of your name. That they would see Christ in us. That our lives would touch others. That we would have the privilege of sharing Christ with others. And Lord, all of this, that your glory would be seen in the world through true Christianity being lived out in our lives. Help us to be faithful. As many have been faithful through the years, as Paul was faithful, as Timothy was faithful, help us to be faithful. Thank you for speaking to us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Pastor.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated for just a moment. The Hebrews Hall of Faith was written to inspire us to be faithful. Anyone and everyone can be faithful to God, to His Word, to His church, giving, sharing your faith. I like what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians. I beseech you, brethren, you know the house of Stephanas, that it is the first fruits of Achaia, and that they have addicted themselves, addicted to the ministry of the saints. What a great addiction. Ministering, loving others. And then in verse 18, for they have refreshed my spirit and yours, therefore acknowledge ye them that are such. He speaks of the coming of Fortunatus and Achaicus. Oh, we have that opportunity. You be faithful on Wednesday night and Thursday night, and you're going to refresh the spirits of some Asian pastors and wives who, as you've mentioned, some are living in difficult conditions. They don't have a lot of support. They might have prayer cards. If they do, be sure to take one and tell them that you will pray for them. Whether it's the Holy Spirit or my idea, I can't say which. But I thought it would be nice if we took a love offering on Wednesday night, just out of your abundance. We divide it up to give them. And then when they do some sightseeing on Saturday in Philadelphia, on Monday in Washington, D.C., they might have a little bit of pocket change. So you decide if it's from Scott Wendell or from the Holy Spirit, but we'll pass a plate on Wednesday night. If you want to have a part of that, we'll be a blessing to them. The Asian pastors will be in all the adult Bible fellowships on Sunday. And so come. If you wear a hearing aid, turn it up, because they're going to have a thick accent, but you'll catch the Word of God. The Word of God is not in the messenger. It's in the Word. The power is in the Word. Ushers, if you'll come at this time, we want to be a blessing to the Herbster team. And so if you'd like to be able to give a love offering for them, if you're unprepared to do so but want to be able to do it, you can drop it off anytime this week up through Wednesday, that we might be a blessing to them to help them on their way. Next Sunday night will be 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock, an early service. Will not be late. Dan Freeman will be preaching. We'll close the service with presentation of these photographs, certificates of completion for the conference, a couple of gifts. We have a engraved pen for them for what they call the Asian Baptist Institute. And so it's going to be a special time to meet these folks and to be able to be a blessing to them. We're going to pray for the offering here. In fact, I'm going to ask Brother Zedzi if we can turn this mic on down here. He'll pray for the offering. Our team is going to come and share some special music. But as you pray for the Herbsters, Margot Cushing just finished her cancer treatments. This is surgery, chemotherapy, radiation. She is hurting, but she's finished it all, and she was out here this morning, most likely watching online tonight. Margot, we want to continue to pray for your recovery, to feel better, and that this treatment will spare your life. Jim Kutz is here tonight. Jim had his mother's farewell service yesterday. Thank the Lord that she's a saved lady and impacted you greatly. And we pray for God's grace and comfort and rejoicing that you know she's in heaven. Pastor DeBoe, it has been 4 weeks, and his heart is beating on its own. He is... they're reducing the sedation. He had fever. I was there, I think I was there Wednesday, and the fever peaked at around 102. The fever is now gone, and he is a miracle man. He has been unconscious for 4 weeks. They're bringing the sedation down, and so we're just going to pray for God's will to be done. But if he rouses to say final goodbyes or returns to us, he is in God's hands. Faithful pastor, retired. Been entering pastoring now for over 10 years here locally, but technically his membership is still here, so we want to pray for Pastor DeBoe as well. So team, if you'll come ahead as we pray for the love offering.
Dear God, we do thank you that the Herbsters can be with us this week. We thank you for their ministry and their faithfulness. Lord, it's an opportunity for us to be faithful at this time and to worship you by giving of a love offering. Pray you'd be able to help them throughout their ministry. We also think of the activities that will be going on this week with the dodgeball with the teens. I pray you'd use the Herbsters in a mighty way to reach them. We thank you for the singing that they've brought to us, and just pray that we can be a blessing to them to this week. We also thank you for Margot, that she got through her cancer treatments. Lord, we pray that they all would be successful and that you would encourage her and her family. We also pray for Pastor DeBoe, helping him and his heart's beating, Lord, but I pray that you might raise him back up, and that your will be fulfilled in his life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much for that. We ask Joe Bono to come lead us in closing prayer. Let's all stand together as we're dismissed in prayer. And we'd like to be able to remind you to pray for tomorrow night, Varner's Outreach there, 5 to 7 p.m., a Halloween alternative. Kids can dress up as Bible characters or animals, something like that. Come out and have a great time together. And then for those hosts and hostesses, please join me in the chapel for just a very short meeting. For the Bono.
Let's pray. Father, I thank you for a day in your house, Lord. I just thank you that we have the Herbster team here, Lord. I just think of this coming week. We commit it to you. There's been many hours of preparation for these pastors to come over, Lord, and learn strong doctrine. I just pray, Lord, that you would just go before them and order their steps as they get here. And Lord, I just pray for all the details that need to come together. Lord, for the outreach of Thursday night and tomorrow night at the Varner's. Lord, just so many things going on this week. I pray that we would be a house of prayer this week and being in prayer for all these different things going on. A lot of moving parts. So, Lord, I just pray that as we learn this morning, our worship goes beyond these walls. And, Lord, I just pray that our faithfulness would go beyond the property line. So, Lord, I pray that we'd be faithful this week. Thank you for your faithfulness. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.